y'all don't mind, let's go back to a time we really used to have church. We used to have a good time, praising the Lord, in spirit and in truth.
I love them old
church. That old brother, pick up that old hymn book and
singing,
you knew exactly what he was gonna say. Sisters got happy. Folks start patting their feet, clapping their hands, and all of a sudden, he break off in a song, something like this.
If you have your Bibles, we want to turn to the book of Philippians chapter 2, verses 5 through 11. And we want to just set this lesson up as we find some of the most powerful writings that Paul wrote. Of course, in chapter 1, we find the teachings of Paul as he writes to the church of Philippians, and he is sick, he is in prison, he is in fear that he might lose his life. In some of the most powerful scriptures, in Philippians 1:21, for me to live is Christ, to die is gain, is the backdrop, the melodrama scene of him writing to the church at Philippi to let them know, the church that has known the brotherly love, his appreciation for sending Epaphroditus to him while he's incarcerated and even while he's sick. And I don't know if you've ever been down before and you've been struggling and things haven't been going good and your health is down. While he's sick, there are men who are in the church while he's surrounded by retiring military forces that are around him. He stops to address some of the attitudes and the behaviors of those toward the gospel of Jesus Christ. In Philippians 1, verse number 15, he says, "For I'm set for the defense of the gospel of Jesus Christ."
Amen.
He acknowledges that men sometimes preach out of envy, out of strife, but he wants them to know that regardless of my situation, I'm set for the defense of the gospel of Christ.
Mm-hmm.
By the time he gets to chapter 2, he now begins to talk about the attitude that one must have. What an attitude he displayed in the scriptures. He's sick. He's worried. He's concerned about death. His friend Epaphroditus has come to the prison to visit him, and he is telling him to send him back, and he appreciates the gifts, but he's gotten sick trying to help me. It is this window that he begins to write chapter 2, that Epaphroditus' service was so powerful and so moving from the church that he said that it's an attitude that we have to have when we're serving one another. And I believe that most of the problem in the churches today is that we don't have the attitude of servitude toward one another. Amen.
Amen.
I believe that when Paul was in jail, that it's a rarity that we visit jails and go visit folk who are in jail. Mm-hmm. I think sometimes it's a rarity that we fail to visit hospitals. And I think he takes this time to express that when we talk about the relationship that we have one for another, it ought to be a relationship in which servitude overrides all strenuous situations.
Uh-huh.
And I don't care how tired you are, you're not tired than the person who's been doing 5 years. Y'all ought to say amen.
Amen.
And I don't care how sleepy you are, but you're not the person in the hospital bed that needs to get some sleep and can't sleep because the nurses keep coming in way over in the midnight hour, 2 or 3 o'clock in the morning, checking your vital signs. And he said, you have to have an attitude. And then finally, he said, how do I relate this to the church of Christ? How do I relate this to the leadership at the church? He said, well, first of all, I want to tell you this, because regardless of who it is, you have to have a mind to serve. And if you don't have a mind to serve, you're not much of a church. He said, let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus. You have to have a mind. And as a matter of fact, I want to name this lesson Mission Submission. He said, I'm going to use Jesus Christ and how Jesus served us to show you how we ought to serve one another.
Uh-huh.
Let me say that again. I'm going to use Christ's service and show you that the same mind that Christ had to serve us, that we ought to serve one another.
Amen.
And when we begin to submit ourselves one to another, oh yes, the church will be a better place.
Yeah.
When we begin to serve one another, there'll be joy in the place of jealousy.
Mm-hmm.
When we begin to serve one another, there'll be hope in the place of hate. When we begin to serve one another, there will be victory instead of venomous behavior against one another.
Uh-huh.
When we let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus.
Amen.
How do I become a servant? Well, first of all, let's look at the word submission. As I begin to set up the sermon, we'll find that the Greek word is a literal military term that suggests that the person person now submits themselves to one another willingly, allowing themselves to go under them when really they're equal to them. Mm-hmm. Let me say it again. In order to have the mind of Christ, you have to have a mindset in which you want to serve rather than be served.
Amen.
Uh-huh. You want to give God praise rather than get praise. Mm-hmm. I'm going to stop here for a minute. You want to shout and thank God for how good he is, uh-huh, rather than have somebody shout and tell you how good you are.
Amen.
There's something about the servant's attitude that he has no problem working with or under someone in order to help promote them for the good of the kingdom of God.
Amen.
And one of the things that promote wholeness and wellness in the church is when we can fellowship with one another and have a relationship with one another that lift one another up. In spite of not lifting ourselves up sometimes.
Amen.
And I don't know about you, but every now and again, I need to be lifted up.
Amen.
I get looked at funny at work all the time. I don't come to church to get looked at funny. Every now, I need to see y'all smiling at me.
Amen.
I didn't send your bills to you. The bill man sent your bills to me.
Right.
What you messing with me for? Can't y'all smile every now and again and let me know I'm all right? I wish I had a prayer in church this morning. That would look like I sent the bill. I didn't run your water bill up. I didn't go over your data plan. Amen.
Amen.
I need to be lifted up. You don't know what I've been through this week. Am I right about it?
Uh-huh.
But you have to come in the house of God with a mind of Christ to serve. And I want to lift somebody up today. You
got
to look at your neighbor and say, I'm getting ready to lift you up today.
Now, let me say
that. You can't be looking at them lying. Now, you can't be looking at them like you're going to tear them down. You got to look at them like you. So I'm going to lift you up today.
Uh-huh.
I'm about to praise God. I'm about to give God glory. And it's going to be so contagious, you're going to raise your hand today.
Amen.
Amen. I'm about to give that. Now, don't y'all lie. If you're not going to do it, don't do it.
Amen.
But if you're going to give God glory, you look at your neighbor and say, neighbor, I'm about to shout right now and give God glory.
Amen.
And it's going to be so powerful. Somebody going to lift their hands unto the Lord. Now watch this. He said it's a mindset, and so I've got three P's I'm going to give to you, and let them be yours. And then for those that I'm teaching, whenever a preacher's preaching, he ought to first give the background of the text. He ought to set the context of the text so he's not just saying whatever he want to say in a text.
Uh-huh.
Because he said what he want to say in a text, you haven't heard the word of God.
Yeah.
And so what's in the text is the pedigree of submission. Y'all need to write that down. It's the pedigree of submission. Not only is there the pedigree of submission, but there's the process. Oh my Lord, there's the process of submission. And then lastly, there's the proclamation of submission. Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus, whom being in the form of God, thought it not robbery not to be equal with God. Well, that's his pedigree, that he was God. He is 100% God, and he's 100% man.
Uh-huh.
And he says that in my pedigree, I know that I'm God, but I want you to see this. I'm God, but I'm coming down to serve men.
Uh-huh.
I have pedigree. I was there before the angels was there. I was there before Abraham was there. I was there. I was in heaven. I saw Satan's fall, but I came down. The word became flesh. John 1 and verse 14, dwelt among us. We hid our faces from him. And he said, but I'm here not to be served by you, but I'm here to serve you, even though I have pedigree. As a matter of fact, I want to stop by and tell you that in my family line are nothing but servants. Am I right about it? And one thing about Christ's not going to let his lineage or his pedigree outserve him. It's important that Paul says this because he is preaching to Jews, and he's letting the Jews know that while you respect Abraham, praise God, and Abraham was a good servant. Am I right about it? Abraham in Genesis chapter 22 and verse number 16, it is Abraham who was not going to spare his only son that he would be sacrificed unto God. Jesus says, Abraham will not outserve me. It's in my pedigree. You remember the Jewish saying, we have Abraham, what? Isaac, and what? And Jacob. God says, in order for me to show you the mindset that I have, you don't have fathers, you don't have a patriarchal system, you don't have a group of lineage that will serve you more than I will serve you.
Mm-hmm.
And while Abraham, he offered his son, the Bible said God gave his only begotten son. Y'all about to say amen.
Uh-huh.
He gave. He didn't have a ram in the bush. He was the ram. Am I right about
amen.
It? Abraham, his service does not match in his pedigree of the service that God gave to you and I, when God gave his only begotten son, the Bible says in 1 Peter chapter 1, 19 through 20, that it was the precious blood of Jesus Christ, not the blood of lambs and bulls and goats, but it was the precious blood of Jesus Christ that allowed us to have a right of remissions of sin, who purchased, who redeemed our raggedy soul. We didn't even want to be saved, but the blood, all the precious blood that Abraham didn't shed, that Moses didn't shed, but Jesus said it and said it, and he signed it on Calvary's cross for your sin. And because of that blood, Acts 20 and verse number 28, the Bible says, take heed unto yourself and to the flock in which the Holy Ghost have made you overseers to feed the church of God. It was the blood of Jesus, and not Abraham, and not Isaac, not Jacob, and nobody, but it was the blood of Jesus that purchased the church.
Amen.
And that church is the church of Christ.
Amen.
And that's somebody out of shout amen. And thank you, Jesus. In his pedigree, you'll find that even the patriarchal system paled to his servitude of Christ. In his mission of submission, he overrides David. 1 Samuel chapter 18, verse number 7, the Bible says that Saul had his thousand, but David had his 10,000. But I hear Christ saying that I'm more than a conqueror through him. In other words, you might have won all of that, but you still lost everything when you gave in to Bathsheba. Y'all ought to say amen. That it's not just winning. It's winning and never losing again.
Amen.
You, God has a 33-0 record. Y'all ought to say amen. He established the church. He said, I have taken what you've given me, Lord, and I have lost none of them.
Uh-huh.
He is undefeated. He is undisputed. He is Lord of Lords, King of Kings, Prince of Prince. He is our Savior, our Redeemer, and his service out and it supersedes the patriarchal system and the king system. But not only that, his service overrides every prophet that ever stepped up on the face of the scene.
Mm-hmm.
You remember in the book of Isaiah chapter 6 and verse number 8, when God was looking for a prophet to go out and proclaim the word, to stand against Baal and to stand against false doctrine. Yes, my friend, folk have been teaching false doctrine. Folk been false worshiping God. Folk been false living for a mighty long time.
Uh-huh.
The problem is God has always had to find somebody who's different. Somebody who wanted to stand for something and not fall for everything. Somebody who would give him glory all by himself.
Amen.
So part of our problem in life is that we have an opportunity to serve, and we're around these folk with false belief systems, and we won't say a word. We're sitting around folk right now. We won't tell them that there's one Lord, one faith, and one baptism.
Uh-huh.
We won't tell folk that the Lord established that one church. He established in that one place in Jerusalem, and that the church spread abroad. Am I right about it?
Uh-huh.
We won't tell folk that there's one hope, one calling, even as you're called by the Father, one Father of all, through us all and in all of us. We won't tell folk because the message is not popular.
Mm-hmm.
The message doesn't make folks shout, but it makes them cringe. But I know the Bible is right. Am I right about it?
Because
we know that God didn't establish every church. He established one church.
Amen.
In the days of Isaiah, he had to preach that all the other places of the denomination, all the hills that had been established, were not the place that God had so designed worship. He said, I'm looking for somebody to stand up against Baal, against Assyria, and Syria, against all of these nations, and tell them that I'm God all by myself.
Amen.
That there is but one God. Am I right about it?
Uh-huh.
Hear ye, O Israel, the Lord God is one. Am I right about it? I don't care what you say about Baal. I don't care what you say about the ephods. I don't care about the stuff you say about all these other gods. There's just one God.
Uh-huh.
And Isaiah said, I heard God looking for somebody to stand up. And I believe right now God is looking for men and women to stand up. But in particular, men as preachers to stand up and preach the word of God.
Amen.
To say, here am I, send me. Am I right about it? We need some men that'll stand up and say, here I am, send me. I want you to go downtown and preach to a world that's lost in sin and degradation, and tell them about me. Tell them how I came down. I was in the form of God. I was broke down and made into fashion like men. And so being fashioned like men, I humbled myself.
Uh-huh.
I was obedient unto death, even to the dying of the cross. That's what we're about. We're right about it. I want you to tell them that I had everything, but I left glory to come down so we could all be together again.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't come down here for you to start trying to worship me like you want to worship me. I didn't come down here for you to set up your own churches. I came down here, and it's an old text, Matthew 16, verse number 18, that upon this worship and holy and holiness and in truth. As a matter of fact, this kind of plan that you were doing, I want you to know I don't even listen to Isaiah 59, 1 through 2. The Bible says, behold, the arm of the Lord is not short that it cannot save, or is ear heavy that it cannot hear. But your sin have separated me, and I will not listen to your prayer. Am I right about it? I didn't come down here for you to start your own manual. How dare you try to name your church? There's no name bigger than my name.
Amen.
There's no name better than my name. There's no name more powerful than my name.
Amen.
How dare you call yourself Mount Episcopal? Don't you know everything with a mountain in front of it is going to blow up one day? It's called a volcano. Y'all got to say amen.
Amen.
I don't know about you, but I'm so glad. I'm so glad this morning that I found the Church of Christ.
Am I right about
it? I'm so glad.
Uh-huh.
I'm so glad this morning that I wasn't lost in denominationalism.
Uh-huh.
I'm so glad that I found the Lord's church. And I'm so glad that I didn't find folk faking and pretending. I'm so glad that Jesus lifted me. Y'all
are
saying
amen.
Oh, my goodness. When we look at this great time, we'll find that in submission, not only has he elevated his submissive spirit over anything men could have done. In fact, God says it this way in Romans 5, about verse number 8. He said, for rarely, preadventure would a man die for another man.
Mm-hmm.
Nobody can match the submissive power of God. And the hardest thing for us to do in our marriage is to submit to one another.
Amen.
To willfully submit to one another. So it's interesting because when you look at the Greek word for submission, it is literally a military term, which means that we're put in a hold, we're put in a position until we tap out.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, my goodness. Oh, I'm about to preach now. If I didn't get you the first, I'm going to get you this time. We got some folk that need to tap out this morning.
Amen.
We need to have some folk that God says, okay, you say you want to be in a relationship with me? You're going to have to submit to me. And you don't have a choice. Amen. Now, y'all let me find you. Don't have a choice.
Uh-huh.
Right now, some of you are in a holding position right now. You're trying to get loose, but you can't get loose. You're trying to run from it, but you can't run from it.
Mm-hmm.
You remember what he said in the book of Amos? He said, it'd be like a man. He ran from a bear, and a lion got in behind.
Uh-huh.
He got away from the lion, got in the house, and leaned his hand on the wall, and a poisonous spider bit him. When you try to run from God, David said that he is omnipresent. He said, if I went down, Psalms 139, 1 through 9, if I made my bed in hell, then you were there. If I made my bed in a grave, you were there. If I hid in a cave, you were there. There is no way I can hide from you. And once you tell God and say to God and put him on in baptism and go down into the watery grave, but God says, I got to help you submit. You take it on the number one. I'm the champion of the world and heaven and the universe.
Amen.
And I will not be. You're going to submit to me. You're going to submit. And God said, I'm going to put you in a hole. That's why you've been broke for 10 years.
Mm.
He wants you to tap out. I'm gonna show you about. You've been going through hell not because God's not able to help you, it's because God's allowed you to go through hell because you won't submit to him.
Uh-huh.
I've been having a bad attitude all my life. He said, you're gonna keep on losing boyfriends and girlfriends and jobs, and people are gonna keep on not liking you until you do something about that attitude. I want you to submit whenever you're wrestling. Can I get somebody come up here real quick? I need a specimen. Am I all right now? When you watch, who got to watch WFC? What is it called?
WWF.
That's what they in the underworld wrestling.
Yeah, that's it.
We got our clothes on. Amen. All right. What? He said, I ain't playing that. One of the strategies of submission in this battle is to get the other person to do what?
Tap out.
Tap out.
Yeah.
And so sometimes they'll get them and they'll bend them around like this, and they'll pull on them. And they'll keep pulling. But he about to knock my laptop, but I'm going to show not make a tap out. And he going to keep pulling until he do what?
Yeah.
Now, if he don't tap out, what's going to happen this right here? I'm going to break it.
Yeah.
Some of you have been at your breaking point for a long time.
Yeah.
And God is saying, you're going to submit to me.
Yeah.
I'm going to break.
Somebody tap out, please.
I'm tired of hurting. Tap out. I'm tired of going through stuff. Tap out.
Amen.
Submit.
Amen.
I'm tired of stuff going wrong. Tap out. I'm tired of sick and tired of being sick. up sometime and down most of the time. Tap out! You remember what he said? Here's the breaking point. He said, went down to the potter's house. Seemed to be good to me. And I saw the potter working on the wheel. And he was working on the wheel. And it said it seemed good that the Lord would break the clay into pieces. God says, you see that clay that I broke into pieces? I'll break you into pieces. And I'll put you back together again. God is saying to you, Brother Jesse, he said, I don't know who you think you are, but I'll break your neck before I let you go to the devil. Y'all ought to say amen. Right. I will break you. I'll send you busted, broke up until you get right. In the name of Jesus. I wish I had five people full of the Holy Ghost that knew how to shout every now and again. Amen. Amen. You know how to say thank you, Jesus. Uh-huh. Amen. Amen. God said, and every one of us know that in some place in our life, we need to submit to the will and have the mindset of God ruling our lives.
Amen.
See, we do. Yeah. See, we do. Well, let's look at biblically. The submission part. You remember there was a man named Saul whose name was later turned to Paul. Mm-hmm. He was on the road to Damascus. Uh-huh. And he came into a bout with God. He was riding on his high horse and feeling pretty good about himself. Am I right about it? Now, he just beat up some Christians in the church. Am I right about it? He just drug good God-fearing folk out of the church. You believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God? Come on out here with me. I'm going to take you down there and take you for judgment. They're going to kill you. So put him on the horse and I'm going to take it with him. I'm big time Saul. I'm bad. Ain't nobody better than me. You believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God?
That's right.
Come on with me. I'm going to take you down here too. We're going to kill him. I'm going to throw a rock at him personally and make sure I get him. Am I right about it? You over here singing about Jesus. You won't sing. Well, come on with me. I'm going to get you too. I'm going to straighten you out. But one day he was put in a submission hole. He was riding on the road to Damascus. And God said, friend, I'm going to knock you down off your high horse. Mm-hmm. I believe that there's some folk who are on their high horse. Uh-huh. They had a whole lot of money. They had a whole lot of stuff. God knocked you down off your high horse and stood in front of you. Not only did it knock you down, since you wasn't using your eyes to see right, he blinded you so you couldn't see and just watch you. He didn't even have to swing at you. He didn't knock, he just spoke you, get down, and it fell down and started looking at him and said, and then the next thing Saul says, Lord, Lord, is that you? Am I right about it? Is that you, Lord? What would you have me to do? Yes, that's in the Bible. What would you have me to do? He submitted to the word of God. He submitted to the power of God. But his submission came when he was put in a submission hole on the road of Damascus. Y'all looking at me funny. You remember the man by the name of Jonah. You remember in Jonah chapter 2 and verse number 2. Jonah had been talking smack. He'd been walking around. I'm a big time preacher. I'll preach where I want to preach. I'll go where I want to go. I decide who gets saved and who don't get saved. And I decide where I'm going to go preach. God said, Jonah, head down to Nineveh. Oh, Jonah looked at God and said, I'm going to go all right. Yeah, really? 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 God, never, really, Lord? Really? Went around and paid fair to go a different direction. He said, I'm not going. I'm going to Tarshish. I'm not going down to old Nineveh. Those people are no good. You ain't going to do nothing. Forgive them anyway. But God said, I'm going to have to put you in a submission hole. God made the belly of a great fish a place likened to that. That represented hell. He said, I lifted my eyes in the belly of a whale, and it was like hell. Am I right about it? I want you to know that some of us are in hellish holes. Some of us are in hellish positions, and you're not there by accident. God's trying to get the hell out of you so he can save and use you for his use. Am I right about it? That's why some of y'all won't praise God because you're full of hell, and won't praise God. Amen. That's why some of you won't shout amen because you're just full of hell. But I stopped by to tell you, God will swallow you up. God will make you come out that fish running top speed to a 3-day trip into a day and a half and wasn't bad enough. You just keep on messing with God. You go holler uncle at some point. You keep sitting playing a trick. Everything to have breath out of give God glory in the house of God. God says, you know, you just keep on playing. Some of you right now, getting your fish made right now. Mm-hmm. And when God looking at you, oh, you going to sit up. I see God now just walking around in the pulpit. You going to sit up in my house and not going to give me glory. You won't mess with me. You mess with the Jews. You, as soon as that preacher get through, I'm going to deal with you. I'll see you Monday. And I'm going to see you Tuesday. I'm going to see you Thursday. I will have glory in my house.
Amen.
Amen. He got something ready for you. He got something. We will submit to the power of God. But there is no power more powerful than God. Am I right about it? Yeah. Lastly, we find that even Jesus, when we look at the text, because we read over it way too fast. Everybody turn your Bible back to Philippians chapter 2, around the seventh verse or so. The Bible says that he then made in the likeness of man. I want you to see that. He was then made in the likeness of man.
Verse
8. He then made in verse 8 in the likeness of man. I want you to see that. He was made in the likeness of man. When it came down here, everything a man can feel, he could feel. Every heartache, he had heartache. He was no longer not subjected to what you were not subjected to. You remember it was Jesus in John chapter 11 and verse 35. The Bible said Jesus wept. He cried. Why did he cry? Because he could feel when folk don't believe in him. Uh-huh. When folk have no confidence in him. Uh-huh. He could feel with all his work and all the stuff he's doing. Like a man, he felt what we felt. He knows what it feels like to not be believed in, for folk to dishonor you, disrespect you. And the Bible said Jesus, well, he was made in the likeness of man. And so then being made in the fashion of man. Watch the text. What do you mean? Since he was in man, since he was in flesh, it was naturally in Jesus not to necessarily just go to the cross. Because you're in the flesh, the hardest thing you ever do is to submit yourself to the will of God. Amen. Especially when the will of God is something hard that you don't feel you can handle. Mm-hmm. He's in the likeness of men, made and fashioned in the likeness. And then watch this verse you just read over quick. So he became humble. Let me show you real quick. The very first verse we heard, we see his pedigree. That's God. Uh-huh. Who thought it not robbery to come down and do the work of men. And then being made in the fashion of men, he left his royalty. He left his status. He left his pedigree. Uh-huh. Came down, took on the form of what?
Man.
A servant. But the Bible says that he was what humble? Being what? Made what? Humble. He was obedient. What you mean? In other words, folk who are not humble will never be obedient.